Flynn University, and previously here at the Santa Fe Institute as a postdoctoral fellow. So obviously it's a real pleasure to be back, and I hope this will be fun. I woke up this morning and I had more graphs and plots from my collaborators in California. So I had a lot of fun this morning in the snow trying to update this presentation for you. Before we begin, if you only have one thing to do today, don't do this, do click. So Chloe, my colleague also at CMU, will be giving a talk at 3:30 p.m. today in the smaller, in the Collins conference room. Oops, sorry, it disappeared. There's Chloe. Oh, and then it clicks to the next one, sorry. Chloe will be giving a talk at 3:30 on some of her work on the alt-right online. So it's another thing to do today. My collaborators on this are two undergraduates. Gabe Salmon was at Oberlin, and I was put in touch with him by an old friend who was teaching him in a seminar. So Gabe joined us last summer. He's now in the PhD program at Caltech in bioengineering. And we also brought in Will Thompson, who's the second author on this paper. Will, some of you may know because he was here as an REU at the Santa Fe Institute a few years ago. Will is a perfect companion for us because he comes out of the humanistic tradition. So he spends all of his time learning calculus from Newton's Principia. And as a historian of science, he's been able to help us connect some of our quantitative results that I'll show you to the more mathematical and information theoretic tools that Gabe and I are more familiar with. I hope this talk will provoke you because the basic thing we do as scientists, particularly as physicists, and I think maybe as people who show up at the Santa Fe Institute, is that we think that the best scientific theories we have are unifying theories. We're not particularly concerned, let's say, with their precision or their accuracy. So when we build, let's say, an agent-based model of traffic, we don't really care if we can exactly predict where and when the traffic is going to happen. What we care about is that potentially the theory that we're building is applicable to a wide range of domains, that it generalizes, that it co-explains a lot of different things. So what we like, let's say, about a theory of traffic is not that it's really good at predicting traffic in the Holland Tunnel in Manhattan, but rather that it actually is really good at predicting the traffic in Singapore and London and Burundi. We seek, in other words, theories of everything. So this is Eddie Redmayne here. This dream is a very old dream. It's a dream that well predates the scientific revolution of which we are members. It goes back perhaps at least before the alchemists. The alchemists, of course, were sort of proto-chemists, but also profoundly unscientific creatures. They mixed together the idea of chemistry and psychology. What they were seeking, of course, was the philosopher's stone, some underlying principle that could have a causal effect on any material or mental object in the world. So if we think of ourselves as scientists, but we also see ourselves as driven fundamentally by the desire for a theory of everything, we're in a bit of a quandary. And that's because the scientific revolution began in part by a rejection of all of this. Francis Bacon, who we associate with the origin of the scientific method, it's fair enough to say that he was the first exponent that people really understood. Bacon actually spent all of his time saying, no, like don't do this, right? Don't have, let's say, a metaphysics where you think that the truth is somehow this sort of Platonic form sitting under here, explaining everything, all the diverse phenomena up here. Don't think of this world as a set of shadows where, you know, something hidden in the back is generating the phenomena that you see. Instead, let's take a purely epistemic stance towards the gathering of knowledge. So this is his book, New Organon. It's a terrible sadness that we never had Lisa Jardine visit us. She was meant to be here. Lisa is the editor of the best version of this. In Bacon's New Organon, he said, look, you know, the issue is not that, you know, we're on our way to unifying everything and we're almost at the philosopher's stone and we just need more funding. Bacon said, no, fundamentally, the ideas that are underlying our scientific arguments, or the arguments we're trying to make at the moment, are completely confused. we are absolutely on the wrong track in terms of the basic building blocks of our explanations. And because they are confused, nothing built on them is sound. In other words, Bacon didn't begin with some assertion about the nature of the world. Instead, he began with our own fallibility. The scientific method is a method for learning, not on account of the way the world is. And so Bacon presented as the origin of what today we think of as hypothesis and deduction. At the origin of that is all the things we've been doing wrong beforehand. So for example, he talked about the idols of the tribe. So in the modern era, we would talk about this as bad priors from biology. We can't be good at science if we just naively look around and get a feeling for what's out there. One thing he talks about, again, he doesn't use these words, but pareidolia, the capacity we have for seeing patterns that aren't truly there, patterns that might be biologically useful for us to believe in, but in fact have no underlying causal power. So that's one kind of epistemic quandary that Bacon tries to get us out of. He also has idols of the cave. So these are the not the biological priors, but your individual idiosyncrasies, the fact that you like integrating things, or you really like taking logarithms. Idols of the market. So idols of the market are sort of the generally agreed upon ideas that float around, the things we have to talk about with each other in order to get things done in, let's say, the marketplace. And finally, idols of the theater. So these are actually all of the false philosophers and false theories of the world that we get from Aristotle, let's say, and Plato. What I'm emphasizing here is that Bacon begins the scientific revolution by an epistemic story, how we gain knowledge, as opposed to a metaphysical story, the nature of the world. He doesn't say, look, we should all become physicists because there's going to be an underlying law that explains a bunch of disparate phenomena. He says, I don't know what's out there, but here's what's gone wrong before. So you might think of him as like the world's first Bayesian obsessive, right? He's like the E.T. Janes of the 17th century. Bacon does have a theory of what scientific laws look like. He doesn't just think it's a collection of facts that we're going to tie together with machine learning. Just to walk you through how he does this, he begins with the four Aristotelian causes. So if you haven't encountered these, here's an example. What is the cause of a house? Or what's the cause of this building that we're in? Well, there's a material cause, the bricks. There's an efficient cause, because guys showed up with trucks and hammers to build it. There's a formal cause, so you think of that as the blueprint, and then there's a final cause, and the final cause of the institute is obviously doing great science. First thing Bacon says is forget the final cause. That's obviously outside of the domain of the natural world. And instead, what you are meant to do is, from the material and efficient causes, deduce the formal cause. So for Bacon, what you're going to do is look at the material and efficient features of a system, right? So I'm going to make a particular compound. So I use this substance versus that substance. So you're going to vary the material conditions. You're also going to vary the efficient conditions. So, you know, do I stir it or heat it? And by doing these in different combinations and keeping rigorous track of all the things I've tried, out the other side, I'm going to deduce a formal law or a rule that governs things. In your grade school account of the scientific method, right, so you know you have a plant and you water it, and the other plant you don't water, one you put in the sun and one you don't put in the sun. This is essentially what we get out of Bacon, and the keeping of lists, the keeping of different conditions, of null hypotheses. All of this comes from Bacon. Nowhere in here is there an idea or a sense of what today we would understand as unification, right? There's no claim, for example, that these rules will amalgamate in any particular way. It could just be a whole bunch of exception cases that, okay, yes, with a small restricted domain of materials and practices, these together are linked in such a way by a rule that you can go build a bomb or you can build a house, right? But there's no sense that the rules themselves should derive from each other, or that very disparate parts of a subject should be subject to the same rule. This emerges almost at least 200 years later, the idea that there's something more than just looking at stuff, playing with it in different ways, and trying to derive patterns. We get this first from a guy called William Whewell, and writing in 1847. So here's the Baconian story. You gather some facts, you generalize them, and by keeping track of all the different variations, and out the side you get a rule. The rule is going to predict some new facts about the domain, and you cycle. You do this kind of virtuous scientific cycle here. Whewell, in the 19th century, looks back over the progress of science. So Bacon writes in the early 1600s. That's essentially when we can think of the modern scientific era beginning. So he looks back over 200 years, and he says, well, you know, how did Bacon do? Let's give him, you know, let's grade him on how well he understood science as we see it now. And he points out that Bacon missed something. He missed the following feature. He says, the evidence in favor of our induction, so the evidence in favor of a rule that we've derived, is of a much higher and more forcible character when it enables us to explain and determine cases of a kind different from that which was contemplated in the confirmation of our hypothesis. What he talks about here, he calls this consilience of inductions. So we should like scientific theories when the facts lead us to create rules, and the rules back predict new facts within that domain. But if sometimes we stumble upon a rule that not only explains the facts in the sort of experimental universe that we've been looking at here, but all of a sudden actually also co-explains a totally different domain that we didn't previously think was linked, we should believe that more. That's a norm. I'll get you a second, David. That's a norm, right? There's no reason, there's no way to derive this. This itself is not a scientific theory. Right? This is a new norm of science. It says that you should get a bigger prize, you should get the Nobel Prize if you can find one of these rules. David, yes? Sorry? Whewell, yes. Absolutely, and let me, it's funny, David, this is a point that I'm maybe not as coherent as I might be about. What's wonderful about Bacon is that he's a knowledge gatherer. He's like the proto-statistician, right? He doesn't tell you what the world is like, he tells you the best way to go about getting knowledge about it. Whewell has the same, God, those poor postdocs. So what do I do? Wait, that's great. So that's Baconian science, right? I have a set of facts. I do something. Sam suggests a variation, but there's no sense in which like foot stomping is associated with projection in general. But anyway, so David, Whewell actually takes a position on this. I haven't given you the whole close reading of this. He says that what's nice about your law explaining stuff in another domain is that you couldn't have like faked it. Right, you couldn't have overfit. So it's not just that you're able to explain this and you're able to explain this, but you generated the rule using this stuff and you didn't have this stuff in mind. Yeah, I mean that's you and me kind of riffing on this, but yes, right? Whewell does have a sense of, you know, the difficulty here is we're always subject to the idols of the mind. We're always going to be tricked, right? And this is a new way, this is a new form of not being tricked. I'll give you some examples of consilience. You won't have to read this, but he gives a whole bunch of them. They're actually going to be very useful for us because he's going to be talking about this stuff at the same time as our data is coming in. So he talks about this phenomenon of the colors of thin plates. So if you go outside today, you'll see sort of oil scum on the water, and you'll see these little rainbows, right? So that was something that people tried to explain. And they had this theory of the alternate fits of transmission and reflection. So this was a scientific law that was supposed to explain why you get these different colored fringes. At the same time, or sorry, different colored rainbows, or so the rainbow pattern of light on that oil. At the same time, sitting around was a different phenomenon, fringes and shadows, right? So the little alternate light and dark edges around a around a sharp edge when the light falls upon it. The fringes of shadows was explained with a different scientific law that they called the doctrine of inferences. At some point in time, magically, people realized that the doctrine of inferences could also explain the colors of thin plates. And at this point in time, according to Whewell's theory of how science works, not according to Bacon's, but according to Whewell, this guy is now doing really, really well, right? The doctrine of inferences can explain two different domains. Alternate fits can only explain one. And so we should prefer this for this over this. I'll get you a second. What I hope is sort of clear here is this is weird, right? This is a philosophical or ideological thing over and above science, right? There's no reason why the fact that this explains this should also help us, should also argue in its favor for this, right? This could, in fact, be a better explanation. Yes, Artemy. Right. Mm-hmm. So Whewell actually, Whewell uses Newton as one of his great examples. And I'm going to forget, it's like there's Kepler's third law and there's the ellipticity. These are two different phenomena. Lo and behold, Newton's laws co-explain both, and we should love them for that reason. Bacon doesn't talk about Newton because he's coming a little bit earlier than Newton, doesn't have that in mind. Whewell is somebody saying that unification that you and I think of as like, whoa, that's got to be the origin point. Whewell says that is something of value. That's something we should recognize as valuable. But if you look back in the 1600s, that's not the ideology that's sort of sitting there when they boot up, and the story I'll tell in particular, when they boot up the Royal Society in London. So for us, retrospectively, it's like, wow, look what they discovered. Those norms are not necessarily sitting there to begin with. All right, so let me just sort of help you kind of walk through why how unification works or how consilience works and why you might in fact not want to believe it to begin with. Again, I'm driving this home because it may seem sort of, yes, David. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So like you're all alchemists, right? You guys, your norm about, you know, the grand unified theory is an older norm than the scientific norm. Bacon shows up, and Bacon's not anti-unification. He's just like, that was such a disaster for us that we actually have to rebuild our science. So here's an example of how consilience works in action. This is the grand unified theory of potato chips. I did not come up with this theory. This is on the Squirrel blog. Which is one of these nerdy science things. So first of all, little Baconian aside, you're trying to build a theory about chips, right? The first problem is that you talk to David Krakauer, and he's like, well, there's chips and there's crisps. And it's like, no, actually, that's just an idol of the market. Really, chips and crisps are a word for the same thing. So this guy has proposed a unified theory of chips where basically there's sort of three combinations. There's the salt and vinegar, sour cream and onion, and barbecue poles of chip world. And all chips can be decomposed into combinations of these three elements, right? And, you know, also sitting on top of here, this person has identified this region of culinary repulsion, right? So what's amazing here is that, for example, this unified theory of chips can predict that, you know, honey mustard, if you know honey mustard is here, you know that there can't really be anything sort of more sour creamy than honey mustard without, I don't know, significantly decreasing the amount of barbecue, right? So, you know, why do things cluster here? Because the unified theory of chips says there exists this region of culinary repulsion here. So this kind of explanation of why, you know, human cuisine takes the form it does is a consilience explanation. It's not the kind of science that we all do, right? So let's take the honey mustard versus all dressed chip pairing, right? From the point of view of this consilience explanation, these are kind of close together because there's not a lot of room around here, right, because of this region. If you're like an anthropologist or you're a historian, these things have totally different explanations, right? Like the honey mustard chips come from a particular social process where there was a lot of honey and then the Germans brought in the mustard, and like the all-dressed chip is like neoliberalism, right? While this kind of story, this unification story that attempts to explain all sorts of different social phenomena with an underlying rule principle is something that appeals to some of us, it doesn't appeal to all of us. And maybe when I was at the Institute, I would see these clashes come up from time to time, right? So we'd have an anthropologist, we'd have a physicist give a talk about something in some tribe in the Southwest, and they'd be like, look, I have a three-parameter model that explains 500 years of history. And the anthropologist says, that can't be right because it has not enough parameters. And for an anthropologist, that makes sense. For a physicist who believes in unification, the smaller number of parameters means that it's more likely to generalize, so it should be preferred. Anyway, from this norm, from the idea that scientific explanations are better the more they look like this, we get some of the great moments in science, right? So we get Murray and the quarks, yes? Sorry, yes? Yeah. Oh, thanks. Sorry. Yeah. Yes. I think that's right. I think I will say, Chris, thank you, because I actually misspoke, right? So if you look at Whewell, for example, he doesn't, at least as far as I'm aware, have a theory of parsimony, right? There is a notion of simplicity or parsimony that comes from the consilience itself. Here's my theory, it explains this and this, right? So it's simpler than having this theory and another theory, but there's no claim that the internal structure of this theory ought to be simple. The only prize it gets for Whewell is that it co-explains disparate domains. So there's two notions of simplicity there, and I did blur them, so sorry. Exactly. Exactly, yeah. So this is 21st century, right, stuff that Whewell isn't hooking into. Although I should say the Reverend Bayes is in our data, and we'll get to that in a second. David. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that. Exactly, and I want to be clear that Whewell is not his theory of consilience is not an aesthetic theory. He doesn't say consilience is beautiful, beauty is truth, therefore consilience is an argument for truth. He doesn't make that kind of argument, right? The argument he makes for consilience is, for example, the unexpectedness means that you could not have overfit. You couldn't have tricked yourself into a rule. If you built the rule entirely on this, and it so happens to explain this, you couldn't have tricked yourself. And then let me just bump a little bit here. So then there's also the question of generalization, meaning has the data been gathered or not, or will it be gathered? Under the Baconian thing, generalization is already a good property of scientific laws. So even the law of alternate fits for the colors, if it is to be a good scientific law for Bacon, has to generalize within that domain. So it has to, like, if you do a slightly different experiment, a slightly different variation, it should still work. So the generalization is actually sitting there for Bacon. The idea that a certain kind of unification is an argument for truth is due to Whewell, right? And then we're going to get in a moment to something that sits around for us, which is a notion, and the word has come up, so you guys have set me up well, this notion that actually consilience is beauty, and we should actually prefer beauty. It's a very different kind of argument for the same norm that Whewell holds, right? Again, Whewell has no metaphysics. He has no metaphysics, right? He's simply talking about how do you get best inference to truth. But in the modern era, there's the claim that, in fact, we've been misled, right? We've become so obsessed by this idea of theory unification that we've actually lost sight of what it was really about to begin with. So for Whewell, he introduces the idea of consilience. Consilience takes off so well, right, and not just in the physical sciences, but also, for example, in the new synthesis for biology, consilience has taken off so well that it's actually gone from simply being a principle by which you select theories to almost a kind of non-scientific norm. And so this is a wonderful book by Sabine Hassenfelder, who who I knew back when both of us were dissatisfied with physics. So this just came out, and you should read it. Her story is about how the love of unification has gone wrong, and in part as an attempt to explain why string theory has done nothing for experimental physics since it was invented. All right. So what I've introduced so far, what I hope I've done, is give you a sense, A, that if you believe in unification, you have this weird religious atavistic norm that comes from something like alchemy or even prior, that the scientific revolution, in fact, was not necessarily a rejection of that, but putting that aside to introduce a whole set of different criteria that we think of as hypothesis and deduction and theory testing. Right? Then that this norm re-enters science in the 19th century. So Bacon sets this up in the 1600s. People are doing their things. They're killing mice and starving plants. At some point in time, this idea of unification re-enters by the back door. And that norm has stayed with us. I won't be able to look at the 20th century. Our data don't go that far. There is a sense that unification actually has come to take over from the underlying tools of the scientific method that got us to where we are today. All right. So, where did consilience come from, right? Whewell is looking at how we do science. He's reporting, and he says, look at our best theories. Our best theories have these properties, right? So first of all, how long have those theories been around? How long have theories with those kinds of properties been around? And the second question is, when did we start to care about that particular property of those theories? So I'm going to show you evidence for where this came from, when it emerged, and when we started to care about it. And my data set will be the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. Has anybody here been published in Philtrans? Raise your hands. It is the old, what is it, half and half, David? Several times. So Philosophical Transactions is I can't quite say the first scientific journal because there's a French one, but nobody wants to publish it anymore. Philosophical Transactions is started in 1665, 5 years after the founding of Britain's Royal Society. Britain's Royal Society is the first scientific society, except for the ones that were destroyed in the French Revolution. It's the first scientific society. It is basically a fan club for Francis Bacon. So Francis Bacon, near the end of his life, wrote a science fiction book about a magical institute sitting somewhere remote, where everybody works together across disciplines to discover new truths about the world. This may sound familiar. It was not familiar at the time. In 1660, a group of scientists, although they didn't call themselves that at the time, a group of scientists actually sat down and created that institute. 5 years later, the secretary, Henry Oldenburg, created the first scientific journal. This is Philtrans. Before Philosophical Transactions, we were doing science. The way we did science was we wrote letters to each other. So I would discover something, and I'd write it down, and I'd send it to Chris. And Chris would say, first rule is you have to write back. So he'd write back to me and say, I have received your letter. This is a very interesting letter. I think you've made an error. He would also, if he thought it was interesting enough, copy that letter and send it outwards. So this was called the Republic of Letters. It existed for hundreds of years. Oldenburg basically said, we should stop doing this, or rather, you just send me all the letters, and I'm going to choose the letters that I'm going to publish in this journal, and then all you have to do is read the journal. Out of this, we got a whole bunch of scientific norms. So we already had the norm of be honest and share and don't lie, but now we have a norm of publicity, so that everybody should be able to see it. If I send the letter to Chris, it's up to him who he sends it to, and maybe he knows I don't want Artemy to see it. But with this journal, all of a sudden, everything becomes public, or the norm is publicity. It's also the origin of a bunch of other things, such as peer review. So the first peer-reviewed article was something that appeared in Philtrans I think it may have been in the second journal. And then it also had a commitment to openness, so you had to describe exactly what you did. Anyway, so Philosophical Transactions still exists today, although it's morphed and split over the years. Our data set is every single article published in this journal from the date of its origin, so from this first journal here, all the way up until 1867. The reason we stop at 1867 is then things start getting confusing because they start a whole bunch of other journals and they split and divide and merge. this track here is a continuous single journal in which all of the scientific output of Britain's Royal Society and indeed of the English-speaking, in fact, non-English-speaking world is appearing. So for this period here, if it's like, it's not news unless it's in field trends. To give you a sense of the stuff that's in here, I mentioned Bayes' rule is first published here. This is Ben Franklin's kite experiment, corresponding address, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. You can see in a little bit of this his commitment to open science. So not only is he saying, I flew a kite, but like, here's exactly how you make a kite, right? You have to take two light strips of cedar. Here, near the end of our data, is one of the great consilience theories of all time. It's electromagnetism. Faraday publishes his mathematical account of how electricity and magnetism link together. So we have on the order of 6,000 articles that have been published in this journal over the course of 200 years or more. You can play a lot of games with these. I should say they were all digitized and OCR corrected, and Gabe had to spend a lot of time pulling out. There are people publishing in Latin, and we had to yank those out, and a couple of things in French and German. You can play some games. So for example, here is how people learn to start fudging causation. So here's the percentage of articles that include the word cause or causation over time. You can see we've always cared about causation. And at some point in time, we discover, however, that you maybe don't even have to talk about causation. You can talk about influence. And then they discover, in fact, an even trickier word is correlation, right? So this is the just some games you can play with how science has evolved over time. Was there a question? Sorry. No, very good. Instead of just looking for individual words, we're going to do some text processing on these articles. And in particular, we're going to take each of these articles and represent them as what's called a combination of topics. So if you haven't heard of topic modeling, I'm going to give you a very brief crash course in it. What topic modeling is going to do is take any particular document and decompose it into a combination of broader co-occurring word patterns. So here's the example. I think I stole this slide from Chloe, right? So here you have some document, right? This turns out to be some sort of promo material in Science Magazine. What topic modeling is going to do is say, okay, yes, there's 40,000 words in this document, but maybe there's only 20 word patterns that any document uses. So here, in fact, David has given us four topics, yellow, pink, green, and blue. What topic modeling is going to do is it's going to discover a set of topics defined as lists of words with different probabilities. So for example, the yellow topic here has gene as a particularly common word, DNA is a less common word, and so on. Here's a green topic, brain is the most common word, then neuron and nerve, right? Any particular article is going to draw from a combination of these. And in fact, every single word will then be associated with one of the topics. So what you can see here is that, okay, this is an article on DNA and biological genetics. It's a combination mostly of the yellow topic, the purple topic, and the blue topic. So I no longer have to read this article to get a sense of the fact that it's mostly about, well, it's got some computer stuff, it's got some DNA stuff, and it's got some evolution stuff. And it doesn't, for example, have some neurons. So topic modeling will take these 5,000 articles. It will discover a list of sort of principal components of those articles. It will then go back and tell you each article is this much of component one, component two, component three, and so forth. Topic modeling was introduced back in 2005. Everybody uses it, and the reason everybody uses it is because it works spookily well. What I mean by spookily well is that when you do this, first of all, the topics that come out the other side are really interpretable. It seems to be the case that one way to track the concepts I'm using when I talk is to look not just at the words I'm using, but at the fact that I'm using this word and this other word together, let's say, in the same paragraph. We got into this. I hate doing these things, but then we did it for our French Revolution paper. In that case, we took each of the speeches in that parliament, we took as documents and fit with topic modeling. The topic model in this case was able to discover, for example, not just a paranoia that enemies of the revolution were going to undermine us, but actually three different forms of paranoia. So it was, we've been continually impressed by how well this works. It's quite a simple algorithm, and there's, well, I'm happy to talk with you about how it works afterwards. Here's some examples that come out. So if we dump all the 5,000 articles of philosophical transactions into a topic model, and we say, okay, look, find us 100 components, here's one, topic 83. But yes, Chris. Yeah. Let me give you two things. Yeah. So it's funny actually you mentioned that, because when we run this on the congressional record, we do actually find them in the same topic. In part because there, you know, we're saying like this, you know, fear over undocumented immigrants is leading us to this ridiculous idea of building a wall, versus these illegal immigrants mean that we have to build a wall. So the word wall is linking those words together for us. But your concern is real, right? So for example, if in the 1700s, we all decided to call them undulations, and then at 1701, this word came out and say, we can't say undulations anymore, it's off, we've got to call it waves, that would cause a problem. We might still be able to track it as long as all the other words didn't change simultaneously, but it's going to weaken it, right? One of the ways we overcome this is we look at the topics, and we make sure that, you know, we're not getting two topics that are clearly about the same thing, and one of them shows up and disappears. Here's just an example of some of the sort of principal components of the philosophical transactions database. This is a demography topic. So you can see, for example, not just people counting the number of males and females and the births and deaths. You can also see how they're people using probability theory, how they're using insurance tables and contingency tables, and I think there's somewhere else around here, joint probabilities. This comes out automatically, so that I can say, I can then say, look, give me all the articles highly loaded on topic 83, and let's double check to make sure they're not that they are what we think they are. Kind of passes those tests. Here's topic 95, with words like electricity, electrical, conductor, distance, electrified, electrometer, inch, rod, body, silk, because you've got to rub the thing with silk. This is the electrostatics topic, it appears to be. So papers that are looking at how charged objects attract and repel each other are loaded on this topic. Here's another one. This is topic 31. This is the electromagnetism topic. And in this case, they're concerned not just with magnets, not just with electricity and not just with magnets, but with currents, forces that connect together the magnetic and electrical fields. We have another topic that's sitting next to this one, which is the bar magnets topic, which is essentially the discussion of magnetism in isolation, the kinds of experiments you do with magnetized iron, for example. So what we've done so far, we have 5,000 articles. They go from 1665 to 1867. We're going to break them down into these sort of semantic units. So for every document, we can say, oh, it's 30% demography and 20% nitrogen fertilizer. Can we detect consilience? Can we detect the emergence of things like this, a doctrine of interferences that co-explains different things? What we're going to do is, or rather maybe one of the intuitions here is, if you imagine philosophical transactions evolving from issue to issue, let's say at the beginning we've identified this kind of cool phenomenon we're all interested in, colors of thin plates. So we have articles that talk about the colors that happen when you have like oil slicks. And then, you know, we talk about other stuff, right? So who knows what we're trying to do with that. Then later on, somebody discovers fringes of shadows, right? So the little bands that appear when you have sharp edges. So they talk about that. And then at some point in time, somebody identifies the theory of alternate fits, right? So the theory of alternate fits now is going to explain the colors of thin plates. So you're going to see pairings like this, topic one and topic two, topic one and topic two appearing. As time goes on, at some point in time, someone might discover the doctrine of interferences and use it to explain fringes of shadows. So now we have a linkage between these two. Later, maybe somebody discovers that interferences also can explain the colors of thin plates. And now we start to have combinations like this, where you have the two phenomena, colors and fringes, now linked together by discussion of the doctrine of interferences. Yes? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So maybe my journey went from this. If this is going on, then this could be true. But if this is true, it doesn't mean that this is going on. Yeah. That's good. I'm going to begin slowly, right? So the first thing I'm going to do is just look at the at topics linking together. So different kinds of things that people talk about becoming associated with each other. So there's a really easy way to measure this. It's going to come out of information theory. What we do to look at the linkage between two topics, let's say topic I and topic J, we measure the joint probability of I and J in an issue or a year or a five-year period, measure the joint probability, and divide by the product of the independent probabilities. If this number here is greater than 1, it means that these guys, I and J, are appearing together at rates higher than chance. Usually because these ratios can get very large, they can go to 10 or 100 or even 1,000, we take the logarithm. So Rij is the logarithm of the overabundance of co-occurrence. Right? For any particular topic, we can then say sort of how linky is it, right? How reliably is this topic predictive of other things that appear in that article? So we just average over the linkage of I with everything else. So we take the linkage of Rij and then multiply by the probability of J given I. So that gives us a way to measure how linky something is. And pop quiz, what happens if you average this linkiness over all topics? Then you get what all information theorists know and love, mutual information. So this tells you how much two topics co-occur. This tells you how much a particular topic is a reliable predictor of other things in that document. And this thing here tells you how that overall predictivity is changing in time. Minor point, average linkage actually splits into two things. There's the extent to which topic I predicts topic J, and there's this sort of weird term here of self-prediction term, where topic I sort of predicts its own reappearance. We're really interested in this part here, the extent to which one concept in the document predicts the existence of another. So I'll be plotting this term here over time. That second term is, no, it's not the entropy, but you're making me do this live on stage, so I will work that out on paper. Yeah. So I will skip this because you understand mutual information this way. I'm going to plot now the overall linkiness of philosophical transactions over time from the beginning to the end. Here it is. So this is one of these plots where you're like, okay, I think we found something. Right? At the beginning here in 1660, 1670, people are talking about a bunch of different things, but they're linking them together sort of arbitrarily. Right? We can't seem to find a pattern where, okay, if you're talking about demography, then you're going to probably talk about biological reproduction. Those kinds of regularities in scientific discourse are not there. As time goes on, this rises and rises and rises. So I'll give you a couple fun points here. That's where Whewell says consilience is a thing, right? So that's when Whewell says that things that are really good at linking to other things should be preferred, should grow over time. Yes, Artemy.
Maybe you'll get to this, but it seems like linking it would also go up if topics are mutually exclusive.
So if topics are mutually exclusive, it's a negative log R. It's a negative R term. Something else has to be positive. The Rij is the log of Pij over Pi Pj. So if you're taking the log of something less than 1, then that's going to be a negative. So Rij can be negative. Yeah. Specialization. So yeah, maybe another way to put it is this, right? It could be that we have a lot of really negative, we have a lot of exclusion pairs, right? Maybe some co-occurrence pairs. Actually, what seems to be happening is that we either have no correlation pairs or strong correlation pairs. So good. And actually, Gabe, you're reminding me, Gabe did look at that. So that's where Whewell says consilience is a thing. It's sort of fun because you can see that as scientific discourse is getting increasingly linked together, there are also some reversals. This reversal here is kind of interesting, this part here. So you'll notice that for a while, linkage goes down. This is actually a bad time in the Royal Society. So the joke is that the trustees and the residential faculty started to blur a little bit. And in fact, Whewell and Babbage and a bunch of other people became concerned about what they saw as the decline of the Royal Society at the beginning of the 1800s. You can read about that story in the Philosophical Breakfast Club, which is an excellent book. Yes? Yes. Yeah, yeah. So this is evidence that scientific theories are linking together. In order to believe that that's evidence that scientific theories are linking together, you have to buy the idea that topics are correctly picking up on theories. So grant me that for a moment. What this is saying is that when scientists talk about one thing, it's increasingly predictable what, about the other things that are going to appear in that article. Sorry? Perhaps you would like my next slide. We did a little fit on this, piecewise linear fit. It's not going up all the time. You can see basically that there are 5 eras where, and what I just said is like, look, you know, find me piecewise linear fit for these, and you know, vary the number of parameters. So early on at the beginning, there's some rise in linkage. There's a decline. There's another rise. There's a decline, and then there's this sort of hurrah era here where it keeps going up and up. And my guess is if we can get the later data, we'll see that going. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yes. Uh-huh. Would this be going up or going down? So actually, it would one way to trick this and make it go up is if you had a smaller number of fields, so things would be more predictable. It turns out that the entropy of articles over time is constant. Meaning that you take a document in 1600, it has roughly the same number of topics in it as a document in 1800 or 1900. So that was actually a surprise. I mean, that was the worry at the beginning, was that it wasn't that things were getting more predictable, it was that all the unpredictable things were going away, right? So there's kind of, you know, sort of junky things where they talk about God with everything, that those things are going away. Turns out actually no, like the sort of the total number of scientific topics per unit time discussed is constant. Sorry? Per paper. Yeah, entropy at the paper level. It, yes. No, right. It, yeah. It doesn't rule that out. Uh-huh. Yep. Yeah, so, I mean, the word specialization is funny, right? Because, I mean, it's sort of a kind of a rich term, right? One way to think of specialization is through topic exclusion. And then I might punt to the Artemy question and say, we don't actually see that one topic is anti-predictive of others significantly, right? So if I talk about the mind, I can't talk about DNA. In fact, what we find is that the driver here, the linkage, is on the other side. So people actually co-linking things. Yep. Mm-hmm. So I don't know about the second question. I mean, this is insensitive to article length. I mean, we can look to see the extent to which the statistics are giving us error. So that's part of the error bars here. That varies. So there are sometimes when there's lots of articles, sometimes when there's very few. These are equal bins. So each of these points here is the same number of articles. exactly, yeah. Exactly, yeah. So that's a very helpful point, Sam, right? When the article is published doesn't go into the topic model, right, at any point. Yep. Uh-oh. In an article, yes. Yeah, so, I mean, like, I guess there's two ways to talk about this, right? One is that you can see it as a form of specialization, right? So, you know, it so turns out that when I talk about bar magnets, I no longer talk about demography. Instead, like, my bar magnets are in this domain here, yeah. The other way to talk about it is as people realizing that some things go together and other things don't, right? So that, you know, development and reproduction go with evolution, they don't go with geology. We can look at the evolutionary drivers. So one of the things we see here is that mutual information is going up, but the other question we have is this a process that's being driven by people selectively choosing to work on things that are in fact linking together? So this could be going up for lots of different reasons. One question we have is it going up because people are actually selecting on that particular linkage property? Yes, Artemy.
Would this also predict that the number of topics per paper is going up?
No. So the number of topics per paper is constant across the data set. Right. Uh-huh. So imagine a world of confusion. You have 10 scientific phenomena, and you can't figure out how they go together, right? So like you write the two thumbs paper, I write the two pinkies paper, right? Chris writes the thumb and forefinger paper. So everybody's trying to put them together, but nobody has found a pairing that works. No one has found a pairing that sticks, right? So every article has two topics, yet the mutual information is zero. Like, just because you're working on this topic here, I don't know which of the other nine you've chosen to bring in. They're, like, the things they're talking about are changing. But, so for example, like, okay, there's this big earthquake in Lisbon, right? And it's, and this is 1700s, and everyone wants to, there's like a special issue on Lisbon, right? And it's like, what are the metaphysics of earthquakes, right? I mean, the kinds of things, the kinds of ideas they draw in to explain the Lisbon earthquake, to our eyes, look bananas, right? Obviously, an earthquake is about geology. Like, what else could it be about? People are like, maybe it's about weather. Maybe it's about the magnetical attraction of the Earth's center. Maybe it's about, like, you know, maybe the presence of people cause earthquakes, right? Today, we understand that earthquake phenomena is actually explained by this sort of super theory of geology. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, this another way to think about this is there's greater systematic linkage, right? I mean, the number of topics in a paper, in any particular paper, suppose they're linked in the author's mind, but they're not linked for the field as a whole. Yes, let's see, Josh, yeah. Yes, yeah. That's great. So this is the question that comes up forever for topic modeling, because you have to put in as an outside parameter the number of topics K, right? So the simplest thing is you just try different values of k and you make sure you're getting the same results. So this is not dependent upon k equals 100. So, yeah. So when I say the number of topics across time is constant, I mean for each article, it doesn't use every single topic. Right, so roughly how many topics are there in a single article? So how many non-zero weightings on topics are there in a single article? So that's what I mean when I say the number of topics across time is constant. So every article, in fact, the entropy of an article is really low. There's only four or five topics with non-zero loading in that article, and there's 100 to choose from. I set the 100 by hand at the outset. If I like ratchet that down to 20, right, I get qualitatively similar results. If I ratchet up to 1,000, that's probably too many. I'm overfitting at that point. Yes, Sam? Yep. Well, like 10 to the negative 12, yeah. And that's a typical outcome because of, so the topic model, it's a Bayesian model, and one of its priors is that an article has a small number of topics in it. So it's constantly, it's trying to make a sparse fit of the article. Yep. 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 Yeah. Yeah. You can change it, so one thing you can do is make alpha a hyperparameter. So now you have a big range, and then you allow that to evolve. That doesn't change that much from fixing it. So another way to put it is that topic models, they seem to be getting it right in terms of how people use language. They could have gotten it totally wrong, in which case this would all be, they're problematic here. Yes, David in the back, yeah. Right. So this is a little technical point, but maybe I can walk you through it, David, right? So a topic model has a document. Here's a document. Every single word in the document is given a topic weight. So every single word is associated with a weight over topics. The document as a whole is the average of all those weights. So another way to say it is, I stick my hand in the article, I pull out a word, what's the most likely topic? It's two draws from the same document. If I have, let's say I have a thing where I got an urn. My urn is either all red, is all either half red and half blue, or half blue and half green. I stick my hand in, I pull out green. All of a sudden, I have a lot more knowledge about the color of the next ball. I know it's either going to be green or blue. It can't be red. So they're not IID draws for a Bayesian in that fashion. Conditional upon knowing what's in there, sure, right? But if I stick my hand in, I don't know what the urn is. I pull out a ball. I now get information about the next draw. So think about the first word and the second word then. So my first draw is I look at the first word in the paper. My second draw is I look at the second word in the paper. Yeah. But yeah, you are not alone in your puzzlement, because Gabe and I fussed about this for a while. So I'll show you, just I have a little time here, and then you can yell at me afterwards, because I would love, I mean, the questions here are exactly the kinds of questions we need, because we've been addicted to this for 6 months. Basic thing, this is going up, but like, why is it going up? Well, we'll build a really simple sort of evolution model, kind of a story about how topics might be growing over time. What I'm going to do is I'm going to predict the fraction of topic I at t plus delta, and it's going to be driven by three drivers. The first one is frequency bias. So frequency bias says if this topic, you know, if we're all talking about like string theory today, we're going to be all talking about string theory in a year. So this is measuring frequency bias. We also have something just for fun, I put in velocity bias. So velocity bias says, I don't care how common it is, but if it's rising quickly, let's get on the bandwagon. Like everybody's doing, you know, machine learning right now. And then finally I have, this is the term we're gonna care about, this is linkage bias. So this term here, this coefficient here is gonna be positive if the article is being selected for on the basis of the fact that it's kind of a linky thing, right? So here's the overall outcome. All of these things matter. Frequency bias is interesting. In fact, scientists tend to depart quickly from popular stuff. So if something is high in 1 year, it's actually likely to have gone down the next year. And actually, this is a 5-year time scale. Velocity bias, the same thing. So it so turns out scientists are not actually bandwagon jumpers. Most things that are accelerating upwards decline again. That's a result, you know, there's a reason somebody didn't do that new thing. And here's our lovely term, this is linkage bias. So linkage bias is actually coming in at the same order as these other things and is the one positive predictor of what's going on. The next question is, well, consilience, and you know, we'll argue this in a moment, whether this graph is hooking into something like consilience. If we look at this early period here, linkage is going up, average linkage is going up, but in fact, it's not being selected for, right? So even though things are linking together, it doesn't look like scientists have a preference for the linky type things, right? Stuff that's predictive of other things is not preferentially selected for. It just seems it just so happens that the combination of frequency bias and velocity bias and all the other noise in the system is driving this up. These other two eras here where it's rising, we now see strong selection for linkage. And in fact, this first region here, the linkage is actually twice as high as in the second one here. This is, in fact, where linkage starts to matter for scientists. You can see in this sort of kind of disaster period here, at least from the point of view of Babbage and Hewell, this kind of this period here, the linkage selection goes away again. To be clear, what this linkage means is it says, okay, take the topics here. Why are they high? What's predictive of topics here being high if you look back five years beforehand? Right? So that's, we're saying, okay, why did these guys start to become popular, these ones or these ones? This second band here is an interesting one. It begins roughly, it's roughly associated with, or it's temporally coincident with Franklin's great kite experiment. So this was one of the first, you can think of this as an early unification theory. Lightning is sparks. Lightning is electricity. Lightning is, by a similar phenomenon, electricity is a fluid. I mentioned at the beginning of this idea of a super theory. So not simply that things are being linked together, that things are being co-explained, but the idea that there are things that that there are particularly powerful co-explainers. The great super theory at the end of our data is the unification of all these things that we see when we do bar magnets and compasses, and these things when we get sparks. These are co-explained by this basic theory here that's introduced by Faraday. It shows up a little bit before him in the 1820s. So this is sort of like the doctrine of interferences one. The other thing that kicks in, however, is not just this kind of epistemic co-explaining, but we also see the emergence of super tools. So there's an electrochemistry topic. Electrochemistry is a thing that people are doing. They're learning how to make currents and plate things in acids. At some point in time, electrochemistry starts getting linked to electromagnetism because electrochemistry allows you to make batteries, which allow you to generate currents, which allow you to test these relationships here. So the rising linkage seems to be driven in part by these kinds of consilience events, and I'll give you a few more examples. But we also have things like this. This would be like the shotgun sequencing of 1867. Here's the distribution of topic linkages for three periods. So this is the beginning of that Franklin era. That's in the early days of electromagnetism, and that's at the end of our data set there. So in 1751, you can see most things aren't really predictably linking to anything else. By the time you get to 1867, you have this hard tail here of things that are constantly co-linking with lots of other things. If you dig in there and take a look, here are just some of the examples that you find. So you find the electromagnetism linking. You also find a demography geography linking. So how do we study birth and death rates in different parts of the world? We see a super theory emerging around the combination of botany, soil science, and geology. And then we also see a relationship between theories of animal metabolism and you know what they're peeing out, and agriculture and the science of agriculture. Yes, David. Ah. Yeah. I'll make a hard prediction that you would not see this if you took literary texts, right? So you would not see a more and more reliable linking together of themes. Imagine take the emergence of the romance genre, right, or the detective genre. at some point in time, yeah, look, there's always been puzzles, there's always been love, there's always been murder. Ah, but check it out, the puzzle theme and the murder theme, we're gonna stick those together and make detective genre. So that could be an origin, so it might pick up on genre. I mean, one of the things I take to heart from this discussion, and Artemy, you brought this up, and then this came up over and over again, is this is like the nice story. The nice story here is field unification. But what if it is just specialization? To me, it's clear that, you know, we no longer talk about earthquakes as metaphysical things, right? So we've gotten better at understanding earthquakes, in part by knowing what doesn't go with earthquakes and what does. But it's hard to disentangle that from just sort of blind specialization that says you could never talk about this, or you know, like you only talk about this and this together and never that. Yes, David, sorry. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. The fact that something's a norm doesn't make it wrong, right? So when I say it's a norm, I don't just mean it's an arbitrary convention. I mean it's something that we've chosen to pay attention to and to say is good versus bad. Now, that might be the right call, right? It turns out that, having the norm of promoting Chris because he unifies electricity and magnetism, that norm also, you know, tends to produce better science. But yeah. Ah. Yes. Yeah. So I try to get a little bit along this with the and I'll just scroll back here with this story. So here, right? Consilience is going up. Grant me consilience for a moment. Consilience is going up, but it's not being selected for. So people aren't attending to the fact that those two things are consilient when they decide to work on them later. Okay? So, here there are popular things that are, you know, sort of linkage predictive. Those popular things are there, and they've become more popular, but not because they had high linkage. Right? The growth in those theories can be explained away by something else, right? So, but this is great, David, right? I mean, I would be a bit sad I'm kind of pleased by this result, because it shows that you can have the growth of this linkage without actually a selection for it, right? That can be a byproduct of something else, right? But in these two regimes here, it looks like people are, I mean, again, if you grant the implicit causality here, it looks like people actually are saying, I like that, I'm gonna do something with that. Here's time t. Look at that really linky field. I'm going to work on that for 20 years and do something. There is nobody to stop me talking, so I will be forced to stop myself. Thank you very much for coming.